So let's talk about our game plan. How do we get there? Well, if you've ever scaffolded a function before in Azure Functions, you know that as part of what you do is to first scaffold up a function app. Once you have a function app, you want to scaffold up a function because you have n number of endpoints in that function app. So there's no difference here when it comes to using custom handlers and using Go. So you scaffold up a function, and you author your code in Go. That's the second step. And then you try to listen to a specific route. And as the fourth step, you try to handle the message, which essentially means you're going to read the message and do something with it, which could be printing it or writing it towards a binding. You could also be returning a response. Now, returning a response is not a thing you must do. This is optional. If it's the web, it's very customary to return something. But let's say it's a queue message instead. You don't actually have to return back a response to a queue because the queue shouldn't really know about you. So it doesn't make any sense. But the sixth step that I'm about to show you a bit later is to compile your Go code because you need it to be ones and zeros. You need it to be that executable. And before you come as far as running the function, you need to configure it. And I'm going to show you exactly how you need to configure because it's not a lot, but you need to know how. So looking at a very, very simple project, if some of you have built Azure Functions before, you will probably recognize a few of these files. But what we're looking at after scaffolding is a function endpoint. Now, if you've authored an Azure Functions before in C#, it doesn't look quite like this, but you rather have dedicated C# files. But if you've authored it in JavaScript and TypeScript, this is what you're used to. You have a route subdirectory, and inside of that route, you have a function JSON, and you use that function in JSON to configure things like triggers, bindings, how the route pattern should be. Usually, you're very good with the default values of the route pattern. You also have an host JSON file, and this is very important because this one is going to talk to you, your serverless host. And you have a local settings JSON, which is a great file to use if you got some local settings, for example, to connect to various data sources. And you end up usually to push those to the cloud to your app settings. For example, you have a connection to a database and you want to have a connection string. Local settings is a great place to put it. And now you have the server.go, which is our web app. And if you're on Windows, if you compile the server.go file, you're going to end up with the server.exe. But if you're on Linux, that thing is just going to be called server. So I just want to emphasize that you probably have a code file and you will definitely need to have an executable. And that thing will be produced once you compile it. So server go, server exe. Now, just to show you that the difference between the two apps is not that big. Here, you're looking at two pieces of code from the same code file. I just wanted to split it up a bit so it's easier to see what's what. So if you look at first here, we have our func main. This is our entry point to any Go application. One thing we need to know about custom handlers and using Go in serverless is that it reads towards a very specific port. So instead of you entering port 3000, you go towards this environment variable that the host JSON knows about. And it's called functions underscore custom handler underscore port. That's all you need to remember. You don't need to care about the port. Azure Functions will handle this for you via this parameter.
Okay.
And next thing to happen here is that you set up the route, and you can set that up into anything you want. There's a thing with routes and HTTP that I need to put an emphasis on, and that is that for web apps that only accepts HTTP trigger messages and only writes back HTTP messages, you use something called port forwarding. And what this practically means for you as a developer is that if you've authored Azure Functions before, you know that you usually don't need to specify /API, right? You just specify /products. By me being very explicit here, that means that I'm enabling something called port forwarding. And that forces me as a developer to be very explicit about what I want my full route to be. This is something that's only true for HTTP apps. It's not true for if you're dealing with database triggers or queue message triggers. So yeah, this is really a implementation detail, but it does affect you as a developer. So I just want to mention that. Okay. But I will show you that configuration. So you're not going to be like, oh, but how do I configure port forwarding, right? I will show you. Okay, so this is just your HTTP server being up and running, right? You're saying listen and serve to a certain port. So at this point, this is a one-to-one, you know, between a web app and a serverless function app in Go, right? And here we have our handler function. The first thing we see is parameters, right? We see a response stream that we can write to, and we see a request stream that we can read to. And this is when a user does a request, they might fill in a body if they're doing a post, or they might have something on the URL in your browser where they input parameters. So what I'm doing here is first I'm setting the content type. And when I set the content type, this is for the client, so the client knows what type of content is coming back, so it's able to parse that correctly, right? I set that to be JSON. You can set that to be HTML text if you want to. I just did this to show you how to deal with JSON. Mm-hmm. This endpoint could potentially serve both a GET and a POST. So here I have an if that I say, if you're a GET, just send me hello world back. But if you're of type POST or some other HTTP verb, I'm going to attempt to actually read the body. And the body is a thing that, for example, if you do a web request, you can send JSON or you can send text or a file, whatever you want to put in there, right? And then I end up writing the body back to the user so they see that their post was okay. So this is a fairly simple code, right? Handle a GET or handle a POST, depending what it is, we end up returning different things. All of this, I'm going to take a little poll here from you, Christopher, and see, how do you feel about it so far? Do you feel like you're still looking at a web app?
I, generally speaking, yeah, that it feels relatively natural to me that I can see sort of that normal setup down at the bottom, bringing in the port variable, and then telling it to go ahead and listen on that port, pointing it at then the at the handler, and that handler does look relatively familiar to me, that I can see how it is that I'm going to send information out and how I'm going to read information in. So it feels familiar to me. Yeah.
Super. So do we have any questions about this part, or shall I keep going?
The only little question that I have is just the asterisk that's next to http.request. Does that mean that parameter is optional?
The asterisk next to, sorry.
Next to http.request on the hello handler parameter list.
Oh, yeah, that one. I believe that means it's optional, yes.
Okay.
But you do need to, you don't have to read from the request object, right?
Right.
You can actually just, you know, so, I mean, usually when you have a web request, you tend to be interested in what's coming in, right? Either it's on the URL or on the body. So yeah, I think that's a great question. So let's move on, right?
Yeah.
I said that, okay, these two apps look the same way, right? I said, I think you kind of confirmed and said, oh yeah, okay, it still looks like a web app. But what's the difference? The difference is the configuration file. So as part of those files that you get when you first scaffold your app, you get the host JSON. And what it wants you to do is to add this portion in host.json. This is actually added for you if you select the template that says custom handler. So it adds this entry in that JSON file that's called custom handler. And I want to put your attention to this property because you need to populate that. This one ends up being an empty string to start out with. And this is where they can find your executable application. So you remember a few slides back, I said it's called server.exe. In this case, I've taken it and I compiled it on a Mac, in which case it's not called server.exe, but it's rather called server. What I do need to specify, though, is where do I find this? So if you want to put that executable file under a source directory, you can do so. What you need to do is, in that case, ./.source.server, right? So it finds itself all the way to that executable file. There's another property here because we're, for this time around, we're dealing with HTTP, and I need to enable this port forwarding for it to work properly. Otherwise, it's not going to find my endpoint. So once I enable this configuration, that means that whatever route that I set up, it needs to take you all the way from the root, right? Which means /API/ whatever your endpoint is called. This is a HTTP only thing, right? But you need to enable this too, or it won't play well with web.
Okay.
Oh, let's see here. Okay, so here we actually have a little demo because I wanted to show you all how this would work in real life. So here we have a little pre-recorded video that I have. What you're looking at here is a scaffolded function, and it has host JSON, local settings JSON. It has this hello subdirectory. This is a function endpoint, and it has a server because I compiled this on a Mac. It doesn't have a .exe ending, and it has the server go. And I wanted to show you how to run this function. So if you're looking at this now, you can see that I'm running func start, which starts the app. I get this annoying warning message. You can just ignore it. Once it's done, it's going to show you this is the endpoint. And once I click that endpoint, you can see that it says, hello world. And you can see that this works well. And we have API hello defined. We are reading from the specific environment variable. And that's pretty much it, right? So by using the Azure Functions core tools, we're able to get our function up and running. And because this works because we have our executable server with no .exe because I'm on a Mac, and we've set the configuration correctly so it knows how to find that executable. And that's pretty much it, how to get that your app up and running.